I welcome you all for today's online class on brucellosis. Now, this disease is important because it is seen in India. It is a disease which affects multiple systems. It has varied manifestations, often difficult to diagnose, or often is undiagnosed or misdiagnosed. So before I begin with the disease, let me introduce the organism first. The genus Brucella is named after its discoverer, that is Sir David Bruce in 1886, who isolated this organism in Malta. Malta is in Italy, and in the local language, it is called Melita. Hence the disease, the organism is called Melitensis. This genus has many species, approximately 10 species. All of these are basically animal pathogens, and humans are infected only as zoonotic diseases. So by zoonotic disease, we mean that these are the diseases which are primarily seen in animals, and humans get them when they come in contact with infected animals. So which are the animals that are affected? Goats, cattle, sheep, buffalo, pigs. So these are the animals to which people usually come in contact with. So there are many species of Brucella, but the most pathogenic one is Brucella melitensis. The most or the number one important species of Brucella is Brucella melitensis. Apart from that, other species such as Brucella abortus, suis, or canis can also cause infections. But remember, the most important one is Brucella melitensis. Brucella are gram-negative coccobacilli. Some of them can display bipolar staining. That is, they stain deeply at either ends. This is called bipolar staining. They are all normotile. They don't have capsules, but they are fastidious. By fastidious, we mean that they do not grow on simple medium. So we have to grow them on enriched media. They do not ferment any sugar, and they are basically aerobes. But some of them are capnophilic. For example, Brucella abortus. This is a capnophile. That means it requires an atmosphere that contains 5 to 10% carbon dioxide. Biochemical tests to identify them are few. They are catalase positive. Some of them are urease test positive. Some of them are oxidase positive, but all of them reduce nitrate. Now, how do we classify the different species of Brucella? The classification of Brucella is done on several parameters, such as the requirement of carbon dioxide, production of hydrogen sulfide, and their susceptibility to a phage. This is known as Tbilisi phage. Susceptibility to dyes such as thionine and basic vaccine, as well as agglutination to specific antisera. So these are the methods used to classify Brucella genus. I'm not going to detail about that. So here you see gram-negative coccobacilli. On the left, on the right, you see white spherical convex smooth colonies on blood agar. Now let us have a look at the pathogenesis of this disease. As I already mentioned, brucellosis is a zoonotic disease. This is seen worldwide. It is commonly seen in the Mediterranean countries, Asia, which includes India, Africa, Central and South America. It is rare in Northern America or Central Europe. Around 5 lakh cases of infections are reported worldwide. Now, how many cases are reported from India? We don't have data. This is because it is underreported or it is misdiagnosed. So that is why we do not have data on the presence of brucellosis in India. Brucellosis is an occupational hazard. Where is it seen? It is seen commonly among shepherds, goat herds, farmers, veterinarians, and butchers and abattoir workers because they come in contact with animals. As already mentioned, Brucella melitensis is the most pathogenic one. It is commonly seen in sheep. Melitensis is associated with sheep. Brucella suis is associated with pig. Abortus with cattle. Here you must remember one thing, that they have a predilection for the placenta, which is rich in erythritol. And therefore, in animals, they are frequently responsible for abortions, especially abortus. The name itself suggests its role in abortion. Where are these bacteria found? In animals, they may be found in their reproductive organs. They may cause abortion in them, sterility in them, and these animals shed the bacteria in their urine, milk, vaginal secretions, placenta, or other body fluids. Please remember that brucellosis is also known by a few other names. These are Mediterranean fever, Malta fever, undulant fever, and gastric remittent fever. Malta is because of the region where it was first discovered. Undulant is because the fever comes and goes. So now let us look at the mode of transmission. Infection occurs following ingestion of infected food products, that is meat or milk, undercooked or unpasteurized milk, or through direct contact with infected animals by inhalation of infective aerosols released by the animals. It can also be transmitted through the consumption of undercooked liver or bone marrow. This disease has also been recorded in cases of blood or organ transplantations. Okay, now following infection, let us see what happens next. How do organisms enter the body? These organisms can gain entry through cuts, abrasions, that is breaks in skin or mucous membranes. They can also enter through the conjunctiva. They can also be inhaled into the respiratory tract and consumed into the gastrointestinal tract. Brucella is a facultative intracellular pathogen. By facultative, we mean it can survive both intracellularly as well as extracellularly. And it affects primarily the reticuloendothelial system, liver, spleen, bone marrow. These are the organs which are predominantly affected. Now, these organisms are engulfed by phagocytic cells. We would normally expect that the phagocytic cells would kill them, but that doesn't happen. So, Brucella is able to invade and survive both within the phagocytic as well as the non-phagocytic cells. They are known to survive especially in the mononuclear cells. The incubation period is around 2 to 4 weeks. After they are engulfed by the neutrophils or the macrophages, they are taken inside a phagosome. This phagosome should merge with lysosome, but this doesn't happen. The lipopolysaccharide, which is present on this bacterium, somehow prevents the fusion of phagosome with the lysosome, thereby ensuring its intracellular survival. Not only that, it can also suppress the degranulation of myeloperoxidase containing granules. So the granules which are present inside the phagocytic cells are supposed to degranulate and release myeloperoxidase. This bacterium suppresses that, and thereby it is able to survive within the phagocyte. Brucella do not have any specialized virulence factors. It is not clear how this bacterium is able to manage the disease. Okay, so once they are in the blood, any system can be involved. Through the blood, it is transferred to several parts of the body. It is known to replicate in the lymphatics, kidney, liver, spleen, joints, and it is responsible for both localized disease as well as systemic. When I say focal infection, it means that it can occur in the central nervous system, heart, joints, genitourinary system, pulmonary system, as well as on skin. How does body react? Body reacts to the infection both by the production of antibodies as well as by the cell-mediated immunity. Because this bacterium is predominantly intracellular, antibodies are not very helpful. Therefore, it is the CMI that is helpful. The body reacts by forming granuloma, which may caseate. Over time, they heal by fibrosis and undergo calcification. Now let us look at the clinical presentation in patients with brucellosis. The presentation that are seen in patients with brucellosis or may not be typical. They're not specific to brucellosis. Symptoms can be many. The onset can either be acute or can be insidious, taking a very long time. It can be slow. It can occur as asymptomatic infection, which is sometimes called latent infection. It can be acute, it can be subacute, or it can be chronic, especially when it is more than a year. One of the most characteristic presentation is the fever. It is seen in 80 to 100% of cases. In acute or chronic conditions, it may be intermittent now and then. In 60% of cases, subacute brucellosis, it is undulant, rises and falls. The typical presentation, which include anorexia, fatigue, weakness, malaise, weight loss, are not specific to this disease because these are the conditions which are associated with many diseases, and therefore the diagnosis becomes difficult. This is why it is often misdiagnosed. In 50% of cases, there is arthralgia, pain in the joints, and back pain. Musculoskeletal conditions are very frequent with this condition. Often this is diagnosed when it is investigated for fever of unknown origin. When CNS is involved, you see some neuropsychiatric symptoms, headache and depression, meningoencephalitis, changes in mental status, coma, nuchal rigidity, because it can also cause meningitis, or seizures. This disease, as I said, is quite difficult to diagnose because it has many other diseases which may have similar presentation. The differential diagnosis, the list is long. They include malaria, tuberculosis, very common in India, toxoplasmosis, infectious mononucleosis, this is caused by a virus, hepatitis, HIV, enteric fever, systemic lupus erythematosus. So you must consider all this when making your diagnosis. It also involves gastrointestinal tract. 50% of patients may have complaints such as dyspepsia, abdominal pain. This could be because there could be an abscess in the liver. Patients can either have constipation or diarrhea. Vomiting and nausea may or may not be there. 25% of cases may present with hepatosplenomegaly, and in up to 20% of cases, there may be associated lymphadenopathy. When genitourinary systems are affected, patients may present with orchitis or epididymorchitis or as glomerulonephritis. When respiratory tract is involved, cough and dyspnea may be seen up to 19% of cases. When cardiovascular system are affected, it may present as endocarditis, myocarditis, or pericarditis. Now, as I said, this disease can also become chronic. It is chronic when it lasts beyond a year. This is often seen in patients who are 30 years or more of age. And in these patients, it manifests as low-grade fevers and neuropsychiatric symptoms, especially depression. And they may have chronic fatigue. So chronic fatigue syndrome becomes one of the differential diagnoses. Even after treatment, you must bear in mind that this disease can relapse. So even after treatment, often insufficient treatment, relapses can occur within 2 to 3 months. And when it relapses, patient present with symptoms that is similar to the acute conditions and can be even severe. So this picture summarizes the conditions which are seen in different organ or organ systems. I'll just read this for you. Ocular system, keratitis, uveitis, endophthalmitis, pulmonary system, bronchitis, bronchopneumonia, hilar lymphadenopathy, lung abscess, pleural effusion, gastrointestinal, hepatitis, ileitis, pancreatitis, cholecystitis, and primary bacterial peritonitis. In skin, erythema nodosum vasculitis, CNS, meningitis, encephalitis, psychosis, polyradiculitis, peripheral neuropathy, cardiovascular, endocarditis, myocarditis, pericarditis, genitourinary, epididymorchitis, pyelonephritis, glomerulonephritis, interstitial nephritis, can also cause abortion, skeletal, arthritis, and osteomyelitis. So just look at the wide range of conditions that this disease can present with. How does the body respond? The immune response, as I mainly said, it is controlled by CMI, and the body responds by forming granuloma or microabscesses. If it is CMI that is the chief response, then it can also be detected by a dermal hypersensitivity reaction. This is known as Bruce-Lin test. This is not that commonly done these days. Body reacts by producing antibodies, initially by IgM, followed by IgG and IgA. These are mainly used for diagnosis. Their role in recovery of the disease is not much. Now let us have a look at the ways which we can use laboratory tests to diagnose this. A blood picture. What do we see? Anemia in 75% of cases, thrombocytopenia in 40% of cases, and pancytopenia in 6% of cases. So how do we go about with laboratory diagnosis? The two common methods of diagnosing these are culture and serology. Now, when I say culture, what are the specimens that are taken? The specimen collected from the patient are blood, bone marrow, or tissue samples. Blood and bone marrow are more commonly used. Blood is subjected to blood culture. So around 5 to 10 ml of blood is collected. It is inoculated into brain heart infusion broth, or triptychase soya broth, or brucella broth. These bottles are incubated in the presence of 5 to 10 carbon dioxide at 37 degrees. Please note that this is a slow-growing bacteria. The blood must be subcultured every 3 to 5 days to look for colonies. And if no colonies are found, the process must be repeated for 4 to 6 weeks. So remember that if you are asking for a blood culture of your patient, you must be aware that reports may take up to 4 to 6 weeks to come. This is for culture. Now, if you are subculturing the blood every few days on a solid medium, there are chances that the blood culture bottle may get contaminated. Therefore, this can be avoided by using a biphasic medium. Biphasic medium containing both phases, solid phase as well as liquid phase. This is used also in enteric fever. If you remember, this method is known as Castaneda method. As you can see in this picture here, so this is a blood culture bottle. This is the solid medium and this is the liquid medium. Blood is inoculated into the liquid medium. The whole bottle is incubated. And after 2 to 3 days, the bottle is just tilted so that the blood will flow over the solid medium and the colonies will appear on the solid medium. Now, single blood sample may not be sufficient. It is advised that multiple samples are taken, maybe for 1 to 2 days or 3 days. So blood cultures are positive in only 30 to 50% of cases. So its sensitivity of blood culture is poor. And even among Brucella, Brucella militancy and Swiss are more readily isolated than Brucella abortus. Also be aware that these organisms are highly infectious and that culture and identification of these bacteria must be done in laboratories with biosafety cabinets. Now, instead of blood, bone marrow cultures are more suitable. Bone marrow cultures can be positive in up to 80% of cases. Bone marrow cultures are positive even in patients who have already taken some antibiotics. So apart from blood and bone marrow, other samples that can be taken include the lymph node aspirates, CSF, abscesses, synovial fluid when there is arthritis, pleural fluid. Another way of improving the yield is lysis centrifugation technique. Now, why should this be done? As I already mentioned, the bacteria are present within the blood monocytes. If we are able to lyse the monocytes, the bacteria are now available for culture in the medium. So this is achieved by incorporation of saponin. Saponin lyses the blood cells and then it is centrifuged. This deposit is then taken for culture. So this improves the yield by 60%. So this is the picture that shows the precautions to be taken while handling the blood cultures, because this is highly infectious and several laboratory workers have been infected while performing cultures. Now let us look at the serodiagnosis. Because cultures is not available in many places, culture is difficult, culture is dangerous. Most physicians prefer serodiagnosis. Serodiagnosis is performed by detecting antibodies against Brucella antigens. Antibodies to the smooth lipopolysaccharide appear in the blood of the patient. In early infection, it is the IgM antibodies. They persist at low levels for several months, but it is difficult to detect. They disappear early. IgG appears later, but also declines. So as long as the patient is symptomatic, IgG can be found. But once the patient recovers, even the IgG disappears. So if IgG is present, it indicates that the patient has now gone into chronicity. So presence of IgG indicates chronic infection or possibly relapse. How do we detect the antibodies? There are three types of tests. The simplest one or the most common one is the Rose Bengal CAR test. This is a rapid slide agglutination test. Here, the killed colored suspensions of Brucella abortus are taken and mixed with the patient antibodies. Problem with this is that it has low sensitivity and false positivities are also seen. But the standard or the most reliable test, which is also the gold standard, is the standard agglutination test. This is very popular. What is done here? Here the patient serum is diluted, serial dilutions are made, and then is mixed with killed suspensions of Brucella abortus stain and agglutination is observed. This is a qualitative test. That means we are looking for titers here. Titer of 1 in 160 or more is significant. This is important. 1 in 160 or more is significant titer. In acute infection, it can reach up to 1 in 640 over a period of 3 to 4 weeks. Thereafter, the titer declines. Now, which antibody does this indicate when we are doing standard agglutination test? Agglutination can be either because of IgM or IgG. How do we know? By adding mercaptoethanol, 2-mercaptoethanol, IgM antibodies are destroyed, and then we repeat the test. Then we'll get the titer of exclusive IgG antibodies. As you can see in this picture here, this is the agglutination, which is done in test tubes. False negative results can happen with standard agglutination test. This is because of prozone phenomena. What is prozone phenomena? Prozone phenomena is a condition where a serological test can come negative because of excessive antibodies. So even though antibodies are found in the patient, the test comes negative. Therefore, if you are suspecting brucellosis and the test comes negative, then you must inform the laboratory that you must proceed with diluting the patient serum. So now the patient serum is diluted and repeated. Now the test comes positive. The test can come negative because of presence of blocking antibodies. These are non-agglutinating antibodies, or they may be incomplete antibodies. So because of presence of these incomplete or blocking or non-agglutinating antibodies, the test can come false negative. This can be circumvented by heating the serum at 55 degrees for 30 minutes or by diluting the serum in 4% saline, not 0.5% saline, not 0.9% saline. Instead, we are using 4% saline. It can also be detected by performing the indirect Coombs test. Standard agglutination test also suffers from false positive results. So false positive results can be seen in patients who have been infected by Francisella tularensis, Salmonella urbana, Yersinia enterocoliticus serotype 09, Vibrio cholerae, and E. coli 157, because some antigen cross reaction can occur. As already mentioned, titers of IgG or IgM can be differentiated by performing two mercaptoethanol tests. Other ways of detecting antibodies include ELISA and complement fixation tests. So in this image, you see Ross Bengal card agglutination test. This is negative or control. This is positive, as you can see, agglutination or clumsier. In laboratory diagnosis in animals, cow's milk can be cultured, especially the milk is allowed to form cream, and this overnight cream is cultured. Antibodies in the animals can be detected. There are three ways of doing this. One is known as the milk ring test. Second one is whey agglutination test. And three is the Ross Bengal card test. What you see in this picture is the milk agglutination test. The milk of the animal is taken, and then the colored suspension of the Brucella is abortus is added into the milk. If antibodies are present in the milk, they will form antigen-antibody reaction, and then these antigen-antibody complexes will float at the top as a ring. So presence of ring indicates presence of antibodies or the test is positive. If not, the whole milk will become blue in color. When there is curdling, the clear serum, the clear water-like fluid that is seen is called as the whey. Antibodies can be present in whey. Using this way, agglutination can be performed. Ross Bengal test is used for detecting antibodies in the serum of the animal. Finally, prophylaxis and treatment. Avoiding consumption of undercooked meat or drinking unpasteurized milk. Avoiding contact with sick animals. Okay. How do we protect the animals? By vaccinating them. So there are live attenuated vaccines against brucellosis for animals. Humans also have live attenuated vaccine, but the immunity is short-lived and not everybody requires them. Treatment. Single drug treatment is contraindicated. Treatment is always done using a combination of drugs. The drugs of choice earlier used to be streptomycin, but now it is replaced by gentamicin along with doxycycline. So gentamicin and doxycycline is given. Alternative drugs include rifampicin and trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole. Those people who have been exposed to the bacterium, especially in lab, post-exposure prophylaxis for lab workers can be done using rifampicin and doxycycline. Here, you must remember that relapses can happen despite treatment. So this is something that you must always bear in mind. Often this happens because of partial treatment or incomplete treatment. So with this, I have finished my talk on brucellosis. Thank you very much.